moving the things. Okay, good. Okay, so I would like to start by acknowledging my collaborator in Boulder, Prashant Sardeshmukh. So we know that ENSO can be triggered by extratropical as well as tropical influences, and these influences can also have a subsurface as well as surface manifestation. Some studies have also shown or suggested that different precursors can trigger different type of ENSO event, in particular events the difference in the spatial structure of the sea surface temperature anomaly. So what I would like to do today is to revisit these issues in the context of within a linear inverse modeling framework. The specific question that I would like to ask are, can we associate specific precursors with different types of ENSO event? And what is the relative role of surface and subsurface precursors? For this study, we used the SODA dataset that covers the period from 1958 to 2007, and we have chosen a reanalysis product because we are interested in having subsurface information that are dynamically consistent with the surface information, with the surface field. So Matt Newman has already discussed the linear, the LIM framework. So within this framework, the changes in the state vector X are due to a term that is associated with predictable dynamics as encapsulated by the matrix L and also by a stochastic forcing term. So here we are going to be considering two different type of limbs. In the first one, I will just use sea surface temperature, so by using 20 sea surface temperature EOFs. And the second one will also include thermocline depth, for which I choose the depth of the 15 degrees C isotherm, and I refer to it as Z15. So for a system, of this type, we can find an operator G, the resolvent, that relates the state vector at the time t plus tau to the state vector at the time t, making this framework very suitable for looking at precursors. So the G operator can be calculated based on the covariance matrices of the system at leg zero and at leg tau. So the growth in this system can be calculated, as we see in the bottom panels here, as within the L2 norm, as the ratio for a given leg tau, as the ratio between the variance of the state vector at leg tau divided by the variance of the state vector at leg zero. So, and in the second expression here, we can see that if our initial condition projects on the eigenvector of the GTG operator that have eigenvalues larger than one, then for the leg we will have growth. In particular, we are interested in the initial condition in the leading eigenvector, the one characterized by the maximum eigenvalue. So what is the structure? What is the spatial pattern of that optimal structure? Results are shown here for sea surface temperature on the left and for the extended limb on the right. So the leg we are considering is 6 months. So we show here for the sea surface temperature only limb that this initial condition will evolve after 6 months in a pattern that is similar to the canonical ENSO pattern with maximum anomaly in the Niño 3 and Niño 3.4 regions. For when we include the thermocline, the sea surface temperature field don't change appreciably, but now we have also sea surface temperature information, thermocline depth information. So in the initial state, we have a broad deepening of the thermocline, this yellowish color along the equator, which then evolves to a dipole pattern with deeper thermocline in the east and shallower thermocline in the west. And so the thermocline is flatter here, and this is consistent with the recharge oscillator paradigm. So let's look a little in more detail at this optimal structure. This is a robust structure that emerges across several different data sets, and I'm just going to stick with the sea surface temperature only limb. So in this pattern, we can recognize different features that have been associated with different precursors, in particular these swarm anomalies we have already seen this morning, these swarm anomalies that extend from the northeast toward the equator are similar to the positive component of the Pacific Meridional Mode. In fact, the time series associated to this pattern is pretty well correlated with that index. And we also have in the south this anomaly, especially this part that hugs the coast, that may be reminiscent of the South Pacific Meridional Mode, which has been suggested can favor Eastern Pacific event. There are also negative anomalies in the Northwest Pacific. We only just captured a small part of it, which may be associated with the Northwest Pacific oscillator. So the questions are different parts of this optimal initial anomaly pattern responsible for different parts of the final evolved pattern? And in particular, are they specific parts responsible for the central versus the eastern Pacific warming? So since we are using a linear approach here, we can actually decompose this initial optimal structure in different parts, as shown here. So by construction, these different parts of the initial optimal are spatially orthogonal, so their sum is equal to the sum of the total pattern, and also the evolved structure that we can obtain from them will adapt to the final, patterns. So what do these different parts of the optimal structure, what is their contribution to the final optimal structure? So these are shown here on the right. And as you can see, there are some differences, slight differences in amplitude, also differences in the way this pattern connect to the coast, but they are actually very similar. So based on this analysis, we can really not say that there is some particular part of this structure that lead clearly to events peaking in the Central Pacific versus greater warming in the Eastern Pacific. So then what are the optimal precursors pattern for maximize the sea surface temperature anomaly in the Eastern Pacific, say the Niño 1.2 region, versus the Central Pacific, let's say the Niño 4? So far we have looked at this framework where we were trying to maximize the variance of the old state vector, but we can just be interested in maximizing the variance of part of the state vector, or maybe just an index indicated here by Y of T, which is related to our state vector, but this matrix H, which can be determined through multiple linear regression. So let's say that Y of T is the Niño 1.2 index. So in the sea surface temperature only case, we find that the initial structure is somewhat similar to what we've just seen before, although these positive anomalies here are weaker. The final evolved structure has larger anomalies closer to the eastern part of the basis. However, the real maximum anomalies are outside the Niño 1.2 region, which is indicated here by this box, and they tend to extend quite further west. However, when we include thermocline depth information, we find that now our sea surface temperature pattern in the final state does maximize in the Eastern Pacific and also in the Niño 1.2 region and doesn't extend as further west. The initial thermocline conditions is characterized by deeper anomaly in the Eastern Pacific, shallower anomaly in the Central Pacific. So we already have in the initial state an imprint of this reduced slope of the thermocline. For the Niño 4 region, the initial condition that maximizes the variance in the Niño 4 region is not very different from what we have seen before. But if we include the thermocline, now we have larger anomalies in the central and western Pacific, in particular larger variance in the Niño 4 region. In this case, the initial thermocline conditions, although colors are a little fading here, is characterized by shallower thermocline in the east, deeper thermocline in the central and western Pacific. So in this case, we start with a steeper thermocline in our initial conditions. So the main points I would like to leave you with is that based on this analysis, there is no individual part of the optimal initial anomaly sea surface temperature pattern that is dominantly responsible for creating relatively greater warming in the central versus the eastern Pacific. The inclusion of the thermocline, and particularly the initial subsurface conditions, seem to play an important role for producing relatively greater warming in the central versus the central Pacific, versus the eastern Pacific. And finally, and as a word of caution, We have seen that the differences between these different norms and these different cases are not very large, and they may well be within the noise level. So this is something that we need to further examine to be more sure of the robustness of these results. Thank you.
I think we have only one question. Yes.
And also the fine in the surface temperature only case, the decomposition is pretty clean. So also the evolved pattern, the sum is identical to the total. So it's a little more tricky when you include the thermocline, because then you have to